Hello everyone, and sorry for the title. I hope I didn't hurt anyone saying that your data is useless. It's not you, okay, your data is useless, it's just data is useless. But yeah, welcome. Some of the slides, I don't know if you joined our presentation before, but some of the slides are similar, but the story is kind of different. Yeah, okay.
Hello, Jesus. So my name is Lydia. Okay, so I am just going to brief about GeoGecko, that's me. GeoGecko is a geointelligence company. We work in Uganda, East Africa. What do we do? Geointelligence, maps, insights. I'm not checking the dictionary. But so yes, so this is what we do. And as for people who have who work with geodata, geointelligence or anything similar to that, you will know that data is at the central of the work that we do, and we need data to be able to do our work. So yeah, today we are going to talk about how data is useless in one way or the other. By the end, you'll know exactly why we said that.
Hello, everyone. My name is Desire. I work with GeoGecko, working with all kinds of data, name it. GPS tracks from rangers in conservation parks, satellite imagery, admin units, sanitation toilets in Kampala. So data, one data for us at GeoGecko needs to be not only data but more specifically geodata, data with a location attribute to it. It's not it can't be, data can come in many forms, but it's most usable for us when it has some kind of location component. I guess many of you are familiar with OpenStreetMap. Are we? Yeah. So yeah, it's a collaborative effort from many volunteers to take this imagery, digitize it, and then people on the ground can add attributes. And that's where the trouble begins. It's a good effort, but again. Yes, so there's also challenges with that. For example, OpenStreetMap data is most recognizable through their basemap. But this isn't really data, this is a picture. So if you wanted, you could redigitize all this information, but gladly there's ways to extract that, where you would get this. But they've tried to standardize it in a way with adding tags and helping guide the people that add data to it to, you know, help improve the quality of it, but there's challenges. Most people just do this in their free time, so if I can just draw a few rectangles on the weekend, hey, why not? So that is a challenge maybe Lars will expound on, but another issue we have is data gaps. Most attention is paid to, and this is not, is paid to areas where there's most activity. This is urban centers. A remote village is not going to have that much coverage unless, unfortunately, disaster strikes. And even the same with most satellite companies, because they would only collect data for urban centers and along, how you call it, main roads, highways across the country, and so it's spotty. So whilst you're using your data, if you don't really understand the background to it, hence it's useless. So for example, taking this location, this is what it appears as in OpenStreetMap. It's a base map. This is the data that you have for it, of course. But when you look at the satellite image, most of those white spots are buildings, and you might think no one lives there, but hey. So the completeness of your data set also matters. And that's where I think Lars, my colleague here, can expound upon, because we did a geogecko some analysis to try and see what's out there, especially when it comes to this freely available data. Lars?
Yeah. So because like we are based in Uganda, so we rely very much on OpenStreetMap data. We can rely so much on the government. There is a lot of discussion going on with like who owns data. If I collect data, then I own data, then I don't want to share data. So for many government agencies, OpenStreetMap can be like, yeah, they don't want to go in there because then they suddenly don't own the data anymore, and they are afraid that they will lose power of the data. So if you own a data set, then you have the power, or at least that's what they think. But the problem is that if you don't share data, then it's just useless. Like there have been a few years ago, there was a company flying the entire country of Uganda, made some really good auto photos, and they paid like a shitload of money for that data collection. Then all the data ended up in hard drive at the Ministry of Land, because they basically didn't know what to use it for, but they still owned it. Then we wanted to like, okay, should we try to process it so people can actually get some really nice base maps and so on, and base it and digitalize from it? But then they said, yeah, but then you have to pay for it, because we paid for it. So if you want to use it, then you also have to pay for it. Okay, we can pay for it. And then, okay, but how much should you pay for it? And then there was just like a discussion, like, yeah, we paid like this $1 million for the data collection, so maybe 50% will be fair. And then like, it was just like, nobody will ever pay like that amount. So now the data is just stuck, took forever, and basically it's a few years old now, so now it's useless. So they basically just wasted a lot of money, government money probably funded by the World Bank or the UN or something. And it's basically useless now. It was maybe a few person in the Ministry of Land that ended up using it, and they probably did something great that they know about, but we don't know anything about what they used it for. And we could have used it for so much other stuff. And we will of course have shared, and then the discussion starts. We work a lot with the organizations and people that want to use OpenStreetMap, and they have this idea that they look at the data and then they say, oh, there is data. It's perfect. We can just use OpenStreetMap. We don't even have to ask the government anymore. And then we just make a quick analysis about, okay, this is a client that was working in these two municipalities in Uganda, and they wanted to base all their analytical work on OpenStreetMap, because it's free, it's open, it was easy. But they didn't know that it was not fully mapped. Someone have played that idea in their head that OpenStreetMap is complete, it's a complete data set, it's just free, you can just use it for whatever you want. So this is actually like the green areas is fully mapped, but that also means that they could also just be areas where there's nothing. So it's not because someone had digitalized something in the green areas. The yellow areas is like, okay, someone just has a Wednesday evening and just decided to map one house and then left the area. And then the red areas are not mapped at all. That was like the example that Desai showed before. And yeah, of course, when data is there, it's very easy to export Python, blah, blah, blah. We probably know the story. So yeah, there is data everywhere, and it's cool, and everybody wants to use it, but we have a problem, because there is a lot of people, especially in our region, that collects a lot of data, but they have this idea in their head that now they own the data. They are not so much willing to share it. Of course, there is humanitarian OpenStreetMap and UN that are running some initiative and some projects to share data and collect data, and that's good. But especially in Uganda, I think if you don't include the government and then get them fully on board, then we'll just end in a situation where nobody have an idea what data set to use. We have another This is just the example that we showed it before. In Avua, humanitarian street map have been mapping water points, and they are still mapping water points. Are they working? Are they not working? That's what they are collecting still, and that's good. But in the mean, then you have working water points, non-working water points, and that's good. But at the same time, Ministry of Water in Uganda, they also have their data set. And then suddenly we are in a situation where there is two organizations that basically collect in the same area, and they both think that they have the best data set. So there is a mismatch in this data set. We don't really know if this water point is if that's functional or non-functional, because they don't seem to talk so much, and that's a really bad situation when we are doing this analysis, because this is actually people that are using this data to see if they should build a water point or repair a water point. And it's almost a sport in Africa to build water points. It's better to build than to repair. It's probably easier to get funded. But in many situations, you could like maybe repair 10 water points instead of building one. But if you don't have the data to make these kind of decisions, then you can't make them. So it's maybe understandable that so many water points are being built instead of being repaired. What else? Okay, this is just like, we import it and when we analyze, and then, I think what you saw before was the ministry's water points, and this is the OSM water points. So they are there, and maybe some data sharing has happened at some point, but. So it's not only a problem in Uganda. I think many of us are facing this problem. I'm from Denmark, and I have also been facing problems in Denmark with, like, we have beautiful, nice, free data sets available, and when you try to import those in OpenStreetMap, then there can also be someone from the OpenStreetMap community that don't want me to import 1,000 building outlines that are free. But it's just like there's a problem about who owns the data, and I don't have the answer how to fix it. But I see so many in initiatives that where you can share data, and UN have a lot of portals, but I think you have to be really careful where you take your data from, and I think in our region it's just getting really confused. So that's also we tell our clients that, like, for like we had a few clients that we just tell to use OpenStreetMap as that database, and then they can of course make backups. So if anyone is deleting data, then they can just export it again, or at least they will have their own data set downloaded. But it's like to make this circle of data coming in and coming out, it's just very important. But there is just a lot of issues in this area. I don't have the answer. I will love to hear about what you are doing in this regard. But I think I'm just afraid that there's so many people that are taking decisions based on OpenStreetMap data or government data, and that are wrong, and that's the challenge that we are facing. Data is just useless because there is so much of it, there is so many data sources, and people don't, especially non-GIS people, don't really know that maybe the data set that they are looking at is probably not complete. I think we will like to open up the discussion about your experience with this area, or if you have any questions about how we work with this. I will imagine that it's a problem that you see all over the world. I have seen it in Denmark and Uganda and other places. Do we have another one?
Or I can speak up, I think it's also.
Okay.
Yes, hello, yes, thank you. So, I worked in this region as well in a humanitarian context, remote, I was never there, and we, when we did mapathons and mapping around OpenStreetMap, we did that under the Missing Maps initiative, and I think that is one way that I see, at least in a humanitarian world, that you do things together in a uniform way. But we also had situations where it was a serious discussion, not talking about any specific country, what to put on the map and what actually not to put on the map, because certain refugee camps are actually, you are putting those lives at risk. And there were some examples when they would try to attack a camp because they found it on OpenStreetMap. And I think it's also within the NGO world, also NGOs are competing, and I'm also wondering what would be, wish I would have a solution that you won't do it under your own aegis, but together we would agree on a standard way.
But of course, something like infrastructure, of course you don't, there's different kind of data set that you will put into OpenStreetMap. I understand that concern, but those that want to see where people live, they can also just look at other data sets. Mapathons is also a good idea, but I think for us, we kind of make a boundary. Like, okay, if we're working in this municipality, then we have to know that all buildings, all roads, everything is mapped in this, within this boundary at least. And you.
Thanks for the idea and superb work there. I have a question. On one of your slides, you show the level of, I say completeness, that's not correct, like the coverage of mapping of OpenStreetMap. You say this part is mapped and this part is not mapped. Is this something the OpenStreetMap is providing, or is it something you computed yourself?
It's something we did ourselves.
Okay, is this kind of work shared somewhere? Or I find this approach super interesting, and we have the same kind of problem of people using like data, which is probably unreliable. And so,
part of it was like we went some analysis on like the areas that we could clearly see that there was no reason to check for anything. And then to get the complete picture, we also did some of the manual work. Like what you see here is basically a lot of like 100 by 100 meters, and then so we analyzed every, not all of them manually, but like we ran some analysis so we could at least for the majority of the data we move them, so we could just say that we know for sure that there's no construction in this area. But we don't have, and it will be interesting to develop like a methodology so you can actually make this kind of analysis very quick. And as I see it, there shouldn't be any, you could, it must be possible to make some simple scripts to run this kind of analysis.
Thank you.
But this was just to get the very complete picture of what is going on here.
Is data useless?
Everybody thinks that their data set is the best. That's probably also one of the problems. So yeah. But yeah, if you're making a water point pressure analysis in one of these municipalities, then the existing data is useless because you don't get the complete picture. You can make that analysis of water pressure. I actually didn't show that one. For those who didn't see this, so what this actually show is like functional, and then you have like just simple only polygons like service areas. So it counts all the building outlines within each of the. It's just the shortest line between you and the water point. And then it creates those polygons, and then it counts how many buildings that are within this area. But you can do this in Arua in Uganda because there have been mappetons, and we know that the data set is complete. But you can also, this is based on Uganda government data, the water points. The building outlines are from OpenStreetMap, but there's also water points in OpenStreetMap, but you have to use the official data, and in Uganda, that official data is the government of Uganda, and lucky for us, they share that data for some reason. And these are easy enough to run, like it's just Python running behind it. It's very simple, but you need to know your data. So we could do it here, but we wouldn't be able to do it in these two municipalities that you saw before.